Yo, it's DJ Damage right here at the Serato headquarters in downtown LA. We're about to get to it, baby. Oh, thank God for Serato, because I remember when I was buying records when I was 12 years old, and records, the good records were $6.49 per record. And then if you wanted like the really cool records, they were like $11.49. And I couldn't afford it, man. I couldn't afford doubles. It was tough really navigating through parties at that age. And then boom, Serato come. And I'm telling you, I was literally recording all my vinyl to MP3 on my laptop, because I was like, finally, there's a way for somebody like me who's broke that I can DJ. And then, moving forward, the things Serato has implemented, like cue points, you know, like things that DJs always needed, and they were putting stickers in there to jump to a certain part of the record. Now, clicking a button, it just opened up the creativity for all the DJs to really do what they wanted to do and more. So I'm watching YouTube every day and watching DJs take the things Serato do and take it to the next level, you know, time and time again. So Serato gave us a platform to give us these functions to be more innovative. Social media definitely played a huge role in my success. I remember when I was early in my radio days, being the new DJ going up against historical figures in my city. I'm from Philly. Social media was the biggest platform for me, because at this time, like I said, Twitter was very new. Facebook was very new, and I was one of those DJs, you know, always retweeting my fans and showing them support. And a lot of people was kind of above that, being that the platform was so new, but I was always retweeting my fans. And when I was on the air, so if you didn't know I was on the air, a lot of people would retweet my retweet, and it's like, yo, what's going on the radio? Like, this dude has got all these retweets. What are people listening to? And it actually propelled me to be on a bigger platform very quickly. And we had a lot of engagement, man. I was trending. You know, I remember trending was, you know, trending is still big, but, you know, the trend as a DJ in your city based off retweets and people engaging with you was a huge deal. And that kind of put me on a big platform, you know, for my city. Transition from radio to TV is definitely a hard one, because now you're taking something that's based on your voice into the visual aspect. For me, I'm more of a visual guy anyway. So it was a little easier for me. I wasn't the biggest talk person on the radio. I was really strictly a DJ who kind of ad-libbed my set. So I feel like in TV, I got to show more of my personality. So I would say the transition really is, you know, now you have to really own your personality outside of your voice. It's the way you move, you know, the way you look at people, the way you respond to people, more so than what you're just saying. The interaction on television wasn't tough, like if I would sit down with a guest or whatever, but to just talk to the camera by myself and read a prompt, it was very difficult. You know, I'm not the smartest guy, so it was definitely a big transition learning not only how to read out loud, but how to read something that's moving in front of you. But, you know, eventually a lot of practice, you know, beating myself up, made it happen. And being put under a lot of pressure too, man. Sometimes you gotta put yourself under that pressure to make it happen quicker. I'm still doing television work. I'm getting back into my more serious DJ grind. I feel like for the past few years, I kind of put DJ into a back burner to really push my TV aspirations, which has really helped my brand a lot. And I really urge every DJ to find something outside of DJing, but still closely connected to, you know, burst your brand, because there's so many DJs. I don't care how good of a DJ you are, you have to create something with your brand that sets you apart from other people. So rather it's if you're a chef, or you know what I'm saying? Like, it's something has to be unique about what you deliver, because everybody DJs, and there's a lot of great DJs. So I always urge everybody to do something with their brand that expands them outside of them being a DJ, because that just helps with the bookings. It helps with people knowing who you are, because you can always bring your DJ side into it. You know, I love all the DJs from all the record pools that make these edits. They're the ones inspiring me. I love playing other DJ edits, and it's inspired me to want to do that as well. I'm not mad at DJs that resist technology if you are championing what makes you you. If you resist it, don't hate on it. It's a difference between I don't want to do it, then this is dumb. You know, like if you want to stick to vinyls and doing your thing and rocking like that, there's a place for that, and I even respect that. That's dope. But once you start going, oh, you guys are whack or this is stupid, that's a different conversation. It's like, you know, we're always going to respect what came before us. I know I am. But you can't be mad at people that learn how to take the functions of technology and push the envelope and make live remixes and do live drumming and just create beats, you know, in real time from Ableton and connect it somehow to Serato. That's amazing, man. And that's what a DJ is, man. At the end of the day, the DJ is supposed to rock the crowd and be innovative.